So recollect what we were doing yesterday. Our task was to, look at how we can multiply numbers using this algorithm, Booth's algorithm. We were recoding the multiplier, okay? The challenge I had given you was, see, if I have two n-bit numbers that I need to multiply, each number can be chosen in 2 to the power n ways, right? So if you look at it that way, there are 2 to the power 2n or 4 to the power n possibilities, right? And when n is large, it is not going to be easy to do exhaustive testing. Okay, even for, let us say, n equal to 4, you will have, 4 to the power 4, right? For n equal to 8, you will have 4 to the power 8. So the numbers will, go very fast. They will rise very fast. So you will have to think of a different method to do some testing, right? Or verification, right? That is a challenge. That is a challenge all the verification engineers face. And maybe we can think of some pseudo-random number generators and generating random tests and things like that, right? So let us recap. Somebody has a question? Somebody has a question? BR? BR? Who is BR?
हेलो 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 जी सर
Yeah, go ahead. You had a question?
नो नो नो
आई थिंक ही रिसेंटली ज्वाइन सर दैट्स ऑल
ओके. कैन यू ऑल्सो सी माई विंडो विच आई एम शोइंग राइट नाउ दी जस्ट अ मिनट आई थिंक इट्स बेटर आई सी दिस इज वेरी ट्रिकी बिकॉज इट शोज Now, can you see my window?
Yes, sir.
Editor window?
Yes, sir.
I want to say let us try to multiply these two numbers. Okay. So this, right? Somebody has a lot of music going on.
Yes, sir. Sir, can I mute all and then you please unmute yourself? I can do that.
Yeah.
So I have a control mute all, but then we request that you unmute yourself a little later.
Yeah.
I'm muting all. I'm muting all.
Sir, I think I have
sir, please unmute yourself.
I think I have done that.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. So we were saying this is a multiplicand and this is the multiplier. And the accumulator is initially set to 0, 0, 0. And we were going to have a flag equal to 0, 0, flag equal to 0, or F register. So we look at these two bits, and then we have to do a subtraction, right? So we have to do a subtraction. So how do you subtract 101 from 000? Okay. So this is where you have to understand. I hope you remember your 2's complement number system. So when you subtract 101 from 000, you will get minus 5, and minus 5 is given by this 011, and it will be 1011, right? But that 1 will be ignored. I hope everybody is understanding that, right? So 101, right, is being subtracted from 000, and when I do that, I am going to get 011. Okay, and Q will remain 101 and F will remain 00. So this is after subtract. Then we are going to shift. Right? So when I shift, I'll get 011, and this 1 will shift here and 1 will shift here. Next, we see that, you know, we have a 1 followed by a 0, right? That means we have to add. So for addition, accumulator is 001 and this is 101. So when we add, we'll get 6, which is 1110. And Q will be remain 110 and F will remain 1. So this is after add. And the, when I do a right shift, see, this is treated as a negative number. Okay, when I treat, when I do a right shift, right, I must copy the most significant number as it is. Okay, because when I right shift a negative number, the number cannot become positive. So we have to shift in a 1. So what we shift in will depend on the most significant bit. So we just copy the most significant bit in its position. And Q will remain 110 and F will become remain 1. This is so this 0 will shift here and 11 will shift here and F will remain. Okay. The next one we'll see that, you know, there is a 0 here and a 1 here. That means again we have to do a subtraction. So when I subtract 101 from 111, so accumulator will become 010. And Q will become Q will remain 011, F will remain 0. This is after add. And next, when I shift it, I'll get 001. Q will become 001. So what has happened is, you may be wondering, how come I'm getting answer as 1001, right? We thought it, we were multiplying 5 and 5, right? But what has really happened is we have multiplied minus 3 and minus 3. Okay. See, 101 is a negative number. It is in 2's complement representation. if you want to find its true value, it is actually equal to minus, and you have to take the 2's complement of 101, which is 011. So it actually represents minus 3. Is this point clear to everybody? Anybody has a doubt here? Can you just raise your hand? Because if you have forgotten your 2's complement number system, you will not be able to understand what I just did. So anybody has a doubt? I am looking at a chat box in case anybody has a doubt. So any doubts on how I executed this algorithm? Okay, everybody is okay? All right, so if everybody has followed, let me move on. So yesterday we were looking at Verilog, system Verilog for the same application. This boots.sv that I had created. Okay. This was this was the exercise I had given. So I will send this to you in.
Yes, sir. I will collect it. Sure, sir.
As a matter of fact, I sent it to all the participants also yesterday. Okay. So remember, we had written an interface, right? This interface, okay, it was called multiplier interface, okay, because I had a bus, okay. The bus had a 7-bit multiplier coming in, a 7-bit multiplicand coming into the multiplier. We also had a reset and a clock and a finish, all these things with it. Right. Remember this, everybody? So this is the interface. Why do I need to do interface instead of I could have directly done? Here I could have directly written input and all that, right? The way you would have done in Verilog. Okay. See, if I do that, then unfortunately, you know, the tester, whenever we want to instantiate this boot multiplier module, right, we'll end up duplicating that code. And when we duplicate code, if later somebody were to make some changes, right? Somebody decided to add another control signal for some reason, that would, cause a lot of problems, right? Everybody will have to change it in their respective code. And if they don't do it, all the simulations will fail, design will be incorrect. Okay, so that is why they invented this interface. So I have declared mbus as an instance of multiplier interface. Okay, so this mbus is the name of that bus. Okay, if you want, I can improve this. this is probably better. So I had declared a constant called n, okay, and it was defined to be 8. I had declared another constant called m, which we declared to be 4. If you don't want to call it 4 and you wanted to make it part of, you can also write dollar log 2 of n plus 1. You are allowed to do this because dollar log, I think, is available as a and if you think this may result in a decimal number, you can also say dollar ceiling and all that stuff. You are allowed to make these kind of expressions. Okay. So right now, let us keep it simple and let us just call it 4. Okay, I was going to use a 4-bit counter, right? So inside the boost multiplier, if you remember, I have these registers, the multiplicand register, accumulator, and the Q register. And I had a m-bit counter. And I had programmed them to be like this, n to 1, m to 1. Register. Okay, exactly like the way we showed in the diagram. Then the algorithm was whenever there is a positive edge of the reset or the positive edge of the clock, we need to take action, and that action was check whether it is a reset. Okay. And if it is a reset, this is just a debug. Okay, we can remove this. And we are initializing all the values. Accumulator is set to 0, counter is set to 0, F register is set to 0. Multiplicand is copied from the bus. The Q register is taken from the bus. And we initialize fin to 0. Fin is the finish signal. Okay. Otherwise, it may be the clock that has come in. If it is not a reset, then it must be the clock. So remember how to access reset. It is mbus.reset. Mbus is the name of the bus. And therefore, I have to say mbus.reset. So I'm I can say counter equal to. We were using the case statement to handle the 4 cases 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So if Q1 is 0, okay, Q1 is a significant bit of Q, and F is the F register which we talked about. If they are 0, 0, then we just have to right shift. Nothing is required to be done. So I'm just putting a display statement for debugging. You can avoid also. There is no need for all this. Ultimately, when you create the design, of course, you have to remove all this because synthesis tool will not be able to synthesize dollar display, etc. Okay. So we can remove all this. Right now, I'm going to leave it there. Okay. Similarly, when I see a 1 in the F register and 0, we have to do an addition. And by default, your because we have said logic, right? It's not a signed number. It's a signed number. Okay. As a result, it will complete. It will treat them as 2's complement, and it will do 2's complement arithmetic. Okay. We have to say unsigned in case we want unsigned. There is a qualifier called unsigned that we can add like this. Since I didn't say that, it'll treat it as a 2's complement. And this is a subtract, and this is the 1-1 combination where I don't do anything. I just do a 1. So these are the 4 cases, and then for the purpose of debugging, I'm displaying the contents of these registers. Okay, I can say M is equal to this, then A is equal to this, then Q equal to this, and F equal to this. Then I'm going to do a right shift. Okay, so how do I do the right shift? Remember, I must do a sign. Okay, what is sign extension? If the most significant bit is a 1, I must copy a 1. Otherwise, I must copy a 0. In other words, I just take the most significant bit of the accumulator and copy here. Then accumulator gets copied as it is, and Q register gets copied as it is. So originally, how many bits were there? Accumulator had n bits. Q register had n bits and F register had one bit. So we had 2n plus 1 bits on the left hand side. Here we will have 1 plus n plus 1. So it's a right shift operation. And then I'm displaying the value after right shift. One, we can say after plus or minus. Then we are incrementing the counter, and if the counter has become n, we just raise the fin signal. See, we should not do anything else. See, some people try to stop here. No, don't do all those things. Okay, this is just want this to be synthesizable later. You must remove all these display statements. Right now, I'm going to keep it here. I have provided this if def, okay, as a way to handle such situations. So if some debug switch is turned on, all these display statements will get compiled. If it is not turned on, then these display statements will not get compiled. So we can do that also. If it is very similar to if def in your C language. Any doubts here? Any doubts? Let me see if anybody is writing in the chat box. Sir, we have to always keep the MSB of the accumulator. Yes. The MSB of the accumulator represents the sign. So when we right shift, we must always keep the. So as an example, let me show you here. Suppose the accumulator was now, what is this number in 2's complement? Ask me this question. Gaurav Hirani. So what is this number I wrote in 2's complement? It's a negative number because I have the most significant bit is 1. So what does this number represent? 110. Gaurav Hirani, are you there? See, 110 represents minus 2.
Yes, sir.
With me? when I right shift like this, it will represent plus 3. That will be wrong. If I shift these two bits as they are and then copy the most significant bit as it is, then what does this represent? This represents minus 1. Do you agree? This is minus 1. So this is the wrong right shift. This is the right one. Right shift should divide by 2, isn't it? All of you remember that. A left shift multiplies a number by 2 and a right shift will divide it by 2. So if I divide minus 2 by 2, I should get a minus 1. I should not get plus 3. Okay, so we should always copy the most significant bit as it is. So is that clear to you now? Is that clear to you guys? Huh? Gaurav is saying understood. All right. If Gaurav has understood, I'm happy. Okay. Anybody else who has a doubt? See, please don't hesitate. Okay. But if you don't follow this point, you will struggle. Okay. If you have any doubts here, you should ask. So in signed numbers, when we do a right shift, we copy the most significant bit as it is, and that is also called sign extension. This operation is called sign extension. Just a minute. Sorry, I had a quick interrupt. For example, suppose you have a register. Have you heard of ARM? Microprocessor. That ARM microprocessor, you may have you have 32-bit registers. For example, R1 or R5 or whatever, it is a 32-bit register. Okay, it has 4 bytes. Okay, so B3, B2, B1, B3. And the microprocessor allows you to load either a complete 32-bit number into R5, or it will allow you to load a 16-bit word into B0, B1. Or you can also load a whole byte. Okay, so you can either load a word or load a half word, or load a byte. So suppose I was loading a half word. Okay. Then what can happen is, I don't know what is there in B3, B2. B3, B2 may be some value, but I have initialized B1 to, let us say, 1F and 2E. Now the thing is, if you want to look at R3, R5 as a complete 32-bit number, right, then what should I do? I should initialize these values in B3 and B3. What is the correct number to put there? Some people wrongly think that both of them should be set to 0. Okay. But that is not correct. What you should copy is the most significant bit of this B1. The most significant bit is 0. Then we should initialize B3 and B2 to be all zeros. And if the most significant bit is 1, we should initialize B3 and B2 to FF. Okay. So that is what is called sign extension. Okay. And the point is exactly what we discussed earlier. Otherwise, your arithmetic will be incorrect. Any doubts here? Anybody? And did I come across correctly? Anusha understood. Anusha is saying yes, sir. Yes, sir, for what? You understood. Okay. Anybody else? If you have a doubt, you should ask. Any doubts? Okay. So I'm assuming that everybody is happy. So let's go on. So this is what we did. We made sure that the most significant bit is copied. Okay. Now, how do I test this guy? Okay. I have done my homework and I have created the test bench. I will go through with this whole thing. See, the interface that we created yesterday, right, that multiplier interface, I have put it here in the test bench. Okay. Putting it in a test bench, you don't have to have it in the design. And if you are putting it in a design, you don't need it here. So anyway, it will say that because I'm going to read both the .sv files, right? So I will get unnecessary errors, so I'll only define it once. And I'm defining it outside the module. Okay. This is my test bench module. So I'm going to call it test booth. And notice that I'm using the same test bench here also. I'm sorry, the interface here also. So test booth is a small module which generates test signals for our booth's multiplier, and it also has the same interface. So this interface becomes possible because of this logic thing. Okay, if I did not have that logic construct, then it would have been very difficult, because for the test bench, some of them are outputs, and for the the booth's multiplier, the same signals are inputs. So they have overcome this problem by using that logic construct. So when I say logic, I don't have to say whether it's input or output. Okay. Then I have created one instance of the booth's multiplier. This booth multiplier is the whatever I declared earlier. And then this is the name of the instance. So BM1 is the name of the instance. I can create any number of instances. I'm initial and all that. So initially what? I am having some sort of a counter called count, which I initialize to 0. And as long as it is 20 or less, from 0 to 19, I keep toggling the clock. Okay, so I basically want to give 20 clock pulses. Why 20? Actually, it is not 20 clock pulses, it is 10 clock pulses. Okay. Remember what is happening here. The clock is being toggled. 1 minus clock means if the clock was 0, it will become 1, and if it is 1, it will become 0. Okay. So, and that is happening every 5 units of time. Okay. So, if I plot this clock waveform, how will it look like? Initially, the clock was 0. At 5, it will go up. Okay. And it will remain, you know, like that up to 10. Then it will come down at 10. And then again, it will be 0 and things like that. So this happens at 5. This happens at 10, this happens at 15, etc. So I'm creating that waveform here. Is that clear to everybody? And how many such pulses am I going to give? I'm doing it 20 times. Okay. So 10 clock pulses will get generated. Is that clear to everybody? So this initial block, its role is to create 10 clock pulses. Any doubts there? Sir, if is half word and byte aren't the same? No, half word is 16 bits, byte is 8 bits. In a 32 bit register, a half word means 16 bits and byte is 8 bits. Is that clear, GV? Any other doubts? Any doubts? Then parallelly, see, remember, if I write a number of initial blocks, one after the other, they all happen together. Okay, every one of them starts execution at time t equal to 0. Okay, the simulator will time accordingly. Okay, I have written a monitor here, right? That means I want to monitor these signals. The signals I want to monitor are the clock, reset, register, the multiplicand register, accumulator, and Q register. And I also want to monitor the time. Okay. So when I give this dollar monitor, the difference between dollar display and dollar monitor is, if I put a display here, then it will only display once. Okay. Whereas if I put a dollar monitor, it will display the statement every time the value changes. So if any one of these were to change, other than the time, of course, it will display. So if clock changes, it will go ahead and display. If reset changes, it will display. Anything changes, it will display. Then I want to see, I have, what is the interface that I have got? I know that the boost multiplier responds to reset, right? When reset goes from 0 to 1, it will respond. So I'm going to create a 0 to 1 pulse on reset. And I'm doing it here. Initially, both clock and reset are set to 0. And these are the two numbers I want to multiply, 0, 0, and FF. Okay, I can change it, right? But right now I have kept 0, 0, and FF. Let me change it to something else. Let me first multiply 05 and 05. Then I am at time t equal to 1, I am setting the reset to 1. That means at time 1, the reset went from 0 to 1. And at time 2, the reset goes back to 0. So I created a small pulse on reset. then I will wait for the hardware. See, I am already clocking here. See, clocks are already being supplied. So that Booth's multiplier is now in action. And at some point, it will hopefully raise the fin signal, because that is how it is supposed to work. So I am saying if fin equal to zero, then you know, keep wasting time. Don't do anything. This guy is not going to do anything. Okay, the test bench simply waits for the, I think there is also a wait construct. See, I think the same thing can be done by saying wait. So this also will do the same thing, okay. So you are saying wait for that signal to become one. So I am doing it like this, okay. See, if I don't do this, you know, this is a danger. Okay, if I give this, okay, you may be tempted to write this. So what you are saying is, as long as the fin signal is zero, keep waiting. But unfortunately, when it comes to execute this statement, because time is not getting incremented, it will just get stuck there. Okay, if you do this, your simulator will go and start, you know, an endless loop. So it's better to give a some delay here, one or whatever it is. Now we are going to do a finish. Means our simulation is over. We are going to come out. Okay. Let me try and run this simulation. So I'm going to use the Cadence tool for this. I think I forgot to remove these things. So is it okay? The answer is 25. Okay, see, this number is 25, right? So I took two unsigned numbers. Both of them were, you know, 5. So 5 multiplied by 5 should give me 25. Okay, so this answer is all right. And these are my debug statements that are coming in. You can check it. Okay. So initially I gave a reset pulse. Okay. I may have told you earlier that before I, if I don't do anything, they will be initialized to all unknown values. And because I gave a reset, they got loaded. The multiplicand got loaded to 5, the accumulator got loaded to 0, and the Q register was loaded to the multiplier. Right. So these are the values now. And because I see an F, I think I forgot to print the F value. So F is 0. So 0 and 1 means I am doing a subtract. Okay. So as a result, this will be the new value in the accumulator after subtraction. So it will be a negative value. So it will be minus 5. This is minus 5. And this is the same value 5. Then I'm doing a right shift, and while doing the right shift, I have copied the most significant bit here. Okay, and this one came here. So next I'm going to do an add, because there's a one here and there's a zero here. Okay, That is why it says add here, right? And so on, right? It will keep doing this, and ultimately we'll get this answer. So if you want to try out other values, see, this is where the challenge is, right? I mean, we have got the verification going, but how many such values are you going to change? You see, this 0, 5, maybe I want to try one negative and one positive. So let me try maybe 8f and 0, 5. What is 8f? What is 8f as a negative number? Anybody knows? Who will tell me? Quiz. 8f. What number does it represent in the 2's complement number system? Answer is not minus 1. Gaurav G, it's not correct. This is a negative number because I have a 1 here. So if I want to find out what it really is, I have to take the 2's complement of this number. So how do I take the 2's complement of this number? You have to take the 1's complement and add 1, right? So that number will be, so take the 2's complement, then add 1. So this represents minus what? I believe 113. Correct now? Yeah, I think Gaurav has given the correct answer. Minus 113 is the correct answer. Let me ask you one more question. What does the number FF represent? FF is 1111111. So it's a negative number because I have a 1 here. And if you want to find out what number it is, you have to take the 2's complement. This represents minus 1. So what is FE? Complement is this. This, if I add 1, I'll become. So this represents minus 2. Okay. So in this example, I am trying to multiply minus 113 by 5. That will not work because it's too big a number. So let me not give 8f and minus 5. I can try FF. Okay, this means I'm multiplying minus 113 by minus 1. Okay, so let us try that. So the answer should be plus 113. So if our algorithm is correct, we should get plus 113. So this is 7, 1. So this is 113. You agree? It is plus 113. Everybody agrees that it is 113. Anybody else? So the accumulator is. We can try another case where we have. let us say FF and let us say 0, 1. What should be the value? It should be minus 1, right? So I'm multiplying minus 1 and plus 1. So you have to choose. You have to choose these inputs and run the simulator a number of times, right? And you can use, you know, loops, etc. to make your life easier. Okay, you should not do it the way I'm doing right now. See, I'm repeatedly running the simulator. You got all ones. See, both A and Q are all ones. Okay, this represents minus one in a, as a 16-bit number. Okay, so the answer is correct. Okay. So I believe our Booth's multiplier is working correctly. Okay, anybody has any doubts so far? Any doubts? So earlier I had given you this data type in C in Verilog, right? And I had called it, you know, this. I believe I called it Q. Okay, so let us create a Q as part of this. I can create a queue . So this is how we create a queue. In this case, I want a 8 to 1 test vector. Let us say a multiplicand another one called so both are you know arrays. And I can allocate, you know, I can initialize them to some values. So I can go ahead and say, initially assign the values as follows: mcand array. So 8. FF So I have taken some values. So H here means hexadecimal. I can also do decimal. I can also do binary, etc. Similarly, mplyr array. I will choose some values. Let us say FF. Then maybe I will try see whether multiplication by zero works, right? And lastly, I will have 20. See, this will overflow. You agree? See, 25 multiplied by 25 will result in 625, right? And unfortunately, my numbers, no, it may not overflow. It's okay. 16 bits are enough to. So what I want to do is I want to multiply these two numbers and I want to multiply these two, I want to multiply these two, etc. So I have constructed these in some way. I'll say, hey, two negative numbers are being multiplied. And I want to somehow, I think minus one into minus one equal to plus one is a good test case. One multiplied by two is a good test case. Five multiplied by five and so on. We can try. This is minus 2 and let me try multiplying it with plus 2. Okay, so that should give me plus minus 4. Okay. So I have got a bunch. Okay. Now I can find out you know how many elements there are by using that what was that is either num or something like that. Let us see what will work. So we can say number of test cases so when I say dot num, remember that object oriented programming that we have been talking about, right? So on this mcand array I can call that num, okay, and then I can display. We have to declare num test as an integer. Int is also allowed, integer is also allowed, and I think I told you the difference. Okay, it is the number of states. And earlier, this is how I used to do the simulation. Okay, I would reset and then you know, as soon as the finish was ready, I would complete the simulation. I would say dollar finish. Now I should not finish immediately. I should sort of keep trying different values. Okay, so what I should do now is for equal to 0 I less than num tests I plus plus. I must do this. So initially reset is set to 0, clock is set to 0. Instead of doing 8HFF, I must do mcand array. Become mplyr array. And the clock, earlier I was doing it like this, right? I was doing only 20 clock pulses. So here I can do 20 times that num tests. You may be wondering why am I doing 20? Why not 16? Because 16 will be enough. Okay, I can do 16, but maybe I'm supplying more clocks, okay, than required, but nothing is going to happen. It should still be correct. Okay, so this time I'm going to run a number of test cases. Okay, in this example, I'm running 6 test cases. Okay. And the answer should be here. I can display the answer. What is a multiplicand? It is dollar, I'm sorry, M cand array. In the accumulator and so the two 16, I'm sorry, the two 8-bit registers, when I concatenate them, it will become a 16-bit register. And that is what I am trying to display. Is that clear to everybody? So I am displaying the product. I can put some special statement here. No, not percentage. So let us give this a try. Okay, num is not allowed. Huh? What is allowed? Size maybe. Well, I'm sorry, accumulator will not be available, right? I'm sorry. Accumulator is not available there. Accumulator. I should have written bm1 dot so bm1 is that so I am looking at what is inside BM1, okay, because that is not available to me on this. Okay, my apologies. So this should be BM1 dot accumulator and BM1 dot QList. Doubts there? I am hopefully I am clear to everybody. Ask me any questions if you didn't understand. So now it is going through. Let us see that it succeeded in doing what we expected it to do. Syntactically, now it seems all right. Okay. I'm seeing some small problems. Let us look at. So the first one was see, this is actually two, it is showing it as 255, but I and you know that it is minus one. So minus one times minus one is plus one. Then this is one times two is correct. Five times five is 25 is correct. Then 17, 25 times 25 is 625 is correct. So I have one failure. What is my, okay, no, it's actually correct. 254 is actually minus minus 2. Am I right? 254 is minus 2. Minus 2 times 2 is minus 4. And that minus 4 has been written like this. Okay. So it appears like minus 4, but actually it is appears 532, but it really represents minus 4. So all our test cases are okay. Just that the way it is being written is confusing. Okay. So any doubts on what we did just now? Okay. Did you see how Q was a useful data structure for me? Any doubts? Take a 5 minutes, okay, and think about what we have just done. Okay, get some coffee if you want, okay, and come back and tell me. I'll give you 5 minutes to think and ask me all the questions that you may have.